rabbinical school here in England, where he said like this, and I quote him, doubt is the source of inquiry. Yet large sections of Jews live in self-assured ease. Their religion was part of their contentment. But who wants to live in contentment? And then he continues, Louis Jacobs. Religion is used to comfort the troubled. We should now use it to trouble the comfortable. I agree with that. If religion doesn't trouble, you didn't get it. One of the major functions of religion, in my opinion, is that it needs to create trouble. Why? Because contentment is a disaster. Contentment is great about physical matters. That you're content with your financial situation, with the home which you have. That's all very nice, but not in matters of the spirit. There it is a curse, it's a klala, we say in Hebrew. There it puts people to sleep, spiritually to sleep. It lacks investigation. It lacks surprise, wonder, amazement. Spiritual contentment is always superficial. And therefore we need to get challenged. And religion itself, its purpose is to challenge, not to live a content life. And that's even more true today. Because today we live, as we all know, in a world with very few absolutes. We are living in what is called officially the modern, postmodern world, with all its ups and its downs. Scientific knowledge has given us information that nobody has ever dreamt of. This has challenged us. There are many things which we used to believe and we cannot believe anymore. Philosophy has gone ways which nobody would have thought about, and it has gone there, rightly or wrongly. It's a whole new world in which we live. And therefore we cannot just go on with religion as if nothing happened. We can neither go on with the Jewish tradition as if nothing happened. Big things happened. Serious matters have happened. We may like them, we may dislike them. But there are a challenge. And I love it. I love it because what it really means is that I have to go back to the draw board. I have to rethink my things all over again. And there is no greater experience than that. To have to investigate yourself, not just to accept it because your parents or your grandparents or your rabbis told you so, but because you have to make that investigation on your own. Trying to look for all sorts of ways to understand better what do you stand for. Or, let's be honest, that you no longer can stand for it. And you know what? That is so typically Jewish. This fight. Because we Jews want to sharpen our minds. We won't go for anything less than that. And heresy is a fantastic instrument to bring this about. And I tell you more than that. What I've also learned is this. That there are many things when people say, that's heresy. You're not allowed to say this. You're not allowed to think this. And then afterwards, when I look into it, I realize that it is part of the Jewish tradition. People may call it today heresy, but a long time ago they didn't. There are so many statements in Maimonides which today rabbis will call heresy. But they were written by Maimonides, by the Rambam. And if I look into Tanakh, into the Bible itself, and I read what Yeshaya had to say, Isaiah, Hear me out, Jeremiah. What King Solomon had to say in Kohelet? Well, there's a lot of heresy over there. But it's Jewish, written by deeply believing people. And therefore I had to rethink this over, that perhaps this whole concept of heresy is somewhere else, if at all it really is part of the Jewish tradition. Is there something like Jewish heresy? So my main thesis tonight is this, that heresy has no place in the Jewish tradition for the following reason. We do not know about a concept called heresy. It's a Christian idea. I agree that there is something called in Hebrew apikorsut. The word apikores from the Greek philosopher Epicurus. But if you look into the Jewish tradition, and I'm speaking about the Talmud, and I'm speaking about the earlier traditions, then you will see over there that an apikores, which today is translated as an heretic, really doesn't mean at all an heretic. There are quite a few interpretations, but it basically means, most of the time, a person who makes fun of the sages. Who makes fun of the sages. Who makes fun, perhaps, of the Jewish tradition. Not because he had something deep to say, but because he had, whatever his reasons were, he didn't take it very seriously. He didn't even fight with it seriously. You obviously can only be an apikores when you know what you're speaking about. And the Jewish tradition seems to say, there really isn't God such a thing. There is no such thing as heresy. Doesn't exist within our dictionary. You can say to me, Robert Cardoza, that's not true. Maimonides writes about heresy, writes against it. Maimonides, for example, says that anybody who doesn't believe in the 13 principles of faith, about which, by the way, Louis Jacobs has written in great lengths, most interesting, totally in disagreement, marvelous. Where he says there are 13 dogmas, principles of faith, and if you don't believe in them, you are a heretic. Now, I won't go into this because there's no time for it, that the way how Maimonides formulates that in itself already opens up the question, did he really believe in it himself? And my answer to that is very clear, my friends. Maimonides didn't believe in the 13 principles. He wrote them because there was a need at the time to write them, because people needed to hold on to something. The Jews at the time were tremendously challenged by the Muslims, Islam, by Christianity, and they said to Maimonides, so what are we believing? So Maimonides, I think, would have liked to say, I'm not so sure what we believe. But he couldn't say that because people were looking for certainty. They were looking for certainty. So he made this up. And he started to speak about heresy, and he knew somewhere that it really doesn't fit. Because heresy, and I will explain that in a moment more carefully, means that you deny a dogma. Something which is absolutely clearly established, like you, for example, would find in the Catholic Church. But if you look through the whole of the Talmud, and you look through everything else after that, up till Maimonides at least, then you will see nearly anything is up to discussion. That doesn't mean to say that there are no beliefs within the Jewish tradition. There are definitely beliefs. But they are never boxed in. They are never, let's say, completely worked out to a detail, to the point that you know exactly what it is that you need to know or what you have to believe. And I'll show you later what I mean by that, and I will give you some examples. Hear well what I say, and I want you to write this down. Heresy is the denial of something in which the Jewish tradition does not believe. Did you get it? I repeat. Heresy is the denial of something in which the Jewish tradition does not believe.